First topic that we're going to discuss is the ones of the Schwarzschild solution. So the Schwarzschild solution is by far, I think, is the most interesting solution in GR. Okay. So the first thing, the first difficult thing is to learn how to write Schwarzschild. No, so first of all, you have to find a good chalk. Sorry, there is always this story about so this back chalk, right? No, I don't see any good chalk here. Okay, so the first thing is to be able to write Schwarzschild, which is written like this. Okay, why this solution is what it is and why it's so interesting? Well, first of all, you may not, if you didn't study GR too much, so you may not appreciate how difficult it is to find explicit solutions. Okay? So there is no, it's a set of many coupled nonlinear differential equations. So in general, you're not going to be able to solve the problem exactly. Okay? So from this point of view, all exact solutions are interesting because in general you're not able to find them. Okay, so this of course it's one part. So the fact that it's a fully nonlinear explicit solution of Einstein's equations is already a good point. But of course the interest is that is in physics. So what is the Schwarzschild solution? The Schwarzschild solution is thank you very much. So you are going to change completely the level of the lecture. So what is the Schwarzschild solution? So the Schwarzschild solution is the solution of Einstein's equation in the case of spherical symmetry. And I will explain what it means, but of course it's the basic, so there are two main reasons why this is so interesting. The first reason is that, of course, it's a basis of all the classic test of general relativity, in the sense that, of course, if you want to test general relativity, not only classical, not only in the past, but also nowadays, of course, you want to do it, for example, in the solar system or in some other stellar systems. So, of course, you're interested in a solution with good approximation is spherically symmetric. Okay? So, as we learn the Schwarzschild solution, we are going to study the tests of GR. Okay? So, we're going to learn when and how much general relativity deviates from Newton gravity. Okay. So this is the first reason. The second reason is that while this part of the story is about small deviations from Newton, okay, so we are going to find a limit in which this solution looks a lot like what you expect in Newtonian gravity, but then we look for small deviations and we're going to study what they are. On the other hand, there is another limit in which the solution is completely different from any Newtonian idea, okay? And in particular, it describes what they're called black holes, okay? Okay. Of course, the interest in black holes is enormous, and it has at least two facets. So one is the fact that they are very interesting astrophysical objects, and in particular for your times, as you know very well, the direct observation of black holes with the emission of gravitational waves started a couple of years ago. So this is something that is going on and will go on as you do physics, so this is very, very important. So black holes, so just to give you an idea, if you read Weinberg's book of general relativity, it's clear that the notion of black holes was not digested. So I forget what he says, but it's clear that he doesn't really believe in some sense in the existence of black holes. Okay. So this is just to say that, okay, nowadays not only we believe in the existence of black holes, but it's part of what we are studying, so they are really interesting objects for many reasons: to study general relativity, to test general relativity, test deviation from general relativity, and at the end they are also interesting astrophysical objects with which you can study cosmology. Okay? Not only black holes are also interesting from a more theoretical point of view. We're not going to discuss all this, but generalizations of these solutions to higher dimensions, for example, is very useful in the study of string theory. At the end, black holes are interesting as also quantum mechanical objects, for example, for the study of the information paradox. So these are objects which are both astrophysically interesting, but also theoretically interesting. And everything is encoded in this sparse solution. So let me first of all write the metric. So the metric is usually written in the coordinates with these names, t, r, theta, and phi. And the form of the metric is the following. Where d omega squared is d theta squared plus sine squared theta d phi squared. Okay, let's comment a bit on this solution. Okay, so first of all, this is the metric on a unit sphere. Okay. So, for example, if I ask you, how would you prove this? So if somebody asks you why this is the metric on a unit sphere, what would you say? Okay, I know this, but how do I know this? How would you argue?
Maybe it is a spherical symmetry inside.
Yes, but technically, what kind of calculation? These are also the questions that people will ask you if you do an exam to enter some PhD school or something, you know, because maybe it's something obvious, but you have to argue, no? In a sense, can you tell me why this is the metric on a two-sphere?
Can you compute the curvature?
Yes, this one way, good. So if you calculate the curvature, you're going to find that it's constant. If you calculate the Ricci scalar, so if you trace, it's a scalar, and it will be constant and positive, okay? In particular, it will be equal to 2 in this case. But even more... Good, this is what I would do. I mean, it's a very simple thing, no? So what you can do is you start... because what do we have in mind when we talk about a two-sphere, no? Implicitly... implicitly, what we are saying is that the sphere is a two-dimensional manifold which can be seen as the points at unit distance from the center embedded in three dimensions. Okay. So now you can calculate what is the metric on points which are a unit distance from the center. So you have the metric in the three-dimensional space. Okay. So for example, in Cartesian coordinates, you have the metric, the unit metric on R3 is just simply this. Okay. These are not very nice coordinates if you want to talk about a unit sphere, but you know that you can describe the same space using coordinates R, theta, and phi. Okay, and the metric, if you do the change of coordinates, will be like the omega scalar, which is that. So this means that now if I want to restrict to a surface which is at unit distance from the center, so that is to say at r equal to 1, okay, without being too formal, what you're saying is that you are not moving in the r direction, so you are restricting your metric to this surface, so r is equal to 1, so the metric induced on the unit sphere is the one that you read here. Okay, so this is one way to argue. And also your way is good. Any question about this? So let me also mention one thing. Be careful that the name that we give to coordinates, we are leaving a lot of things which are a bit implicit. For example, I didn't tell you, but of course I was implicitly assuming some these coordinates, for example, are periodic, so phi has a period 0 to phi, to pi, and theta as goes from 0 to pi. I mean, be careful about this, because of course, until I talk about object that you already have in mind, this goes without saying. Okay, so you see this and you already have this in mind. Okay. But notice that be careful, because names can be misleading. Let me do an example. I gave you this metric, okay, and so of course you think that t is a time variable, okay, and you're right. On the other hand, you can ask, and we are going to ask, what happens when this parenthesis becomes negative? Because then this variable that, okay, I can call it t, but I mean, of course, when this part becomes negative, this will not be in any sense a time variable. Okay, so be careful about this kind of thing. So we also make some assumption about topology. For example, when I give you this metric on a two sphere, I'm a bit, a mathematician would maybe object, in a sense, to give proper coordinates on the sphere, you should map the sphere in open neighborhoods in R2. So to give coordinates means to make mappings between the manifold and open sets in Rn, in this case R2. Of course, I cannot cover the whole sphere with one single chart. So whenever we say something like this, we are sort of, again, using the intuition that if you are living, for example, at the North Pole, this is a bit singular. But since we know that we're talking about the sphere, we know what to do. Okay? But be careful, because at a certain point, if I hand you a metric with random names of coordinates, A, B, C, and D, all these questions will come to your mind, no? Because then there is no implicit meaning. So everything will become more interesting, if you want. Okay, how do I find this solution? Well, first of all, this is a solution of what? Well, of course, it's a solution of Einstein's equations. And let me write here what Einstein's equations are. Einstein's equation, these are Einstein's equations, so the Sparky solution is a solution actually of this equation. Okay. So it's a solution of zero Ricci, so the Ricci is equal to zero, the Ricci tensor. Now, it's a solution in vacuum, okay? I'm going to say something obvious, but let's put everything clear. Of course, I'm describing the metric around an object, okay, with spherical symmetry. Okay. But of course, I write the metric outside the object. Okay. So this is, when I say that I solve this equation, is the analog when I do Newtonian gravity to solve the equation for the Newtonian potential, which is Laplacian of phi equal to zero. Okay. So if I am outside the source, I solve Laplace of I equal to zero. Of course, then the boundary condition when I go to small r will be, if there is some mass, it will be there. But I, what I solve outside, both are also in electromagnetics, when I'm outside the charge distribution, I solve this equation. Okay. Even if I'm describing some object. Okay. So I have a question for you. So why I'm solving this equation and not the Einstein tensor equal to zero? Good. I said this equal to zero, but then why this equal to zero? Sorry, guys, you should tell me.
In fact, you know, there is a sort of blindness when you're here. Eh?
Sorry. That was an interesting equation before. Sorry. Yes, now the question makes more sense. So, why solving Einstein tensor equal to zero implies this equation? Yes. So did you see this? I ask, but if somebody, I mean, okay, maybe some of you knows, but if somebody never saw this, it's better if you ask me. But let me repeat it. So this is let me check explicitly. What you can do, you can always write this equation in what is called trace reversed form. So if you take the trace of this equation, so you get r from this, then you get minus 1 half r. The trace of gmu is 4. What?
4.
Okay. It's 4. Okay. And here I get, okay, there is not, but I get 8 pi g, the trace of the stress energy tensor. You can see that this is equal to zero, because I'm assuming that this is equal to zero. This means, of course, that the Ricci scalar is equal to zero, so you see that this term drops, and I'm left with this equation. Of course, sorry, I'm using this to see what is the situation. Another question that people will ask you in every typical exam you said this equal to zero. Does it mean that this metric is flat? No, it's a question. Maybe it's a stupid question, but you should answer. So does it mean, so because I seem to say that I want some sort of curvature equal to zero, but if does this equation imply that this metric is flat?
And we need to check the Riemann tensor.
Good. So I remind you that this object is a trace of a Riemann tensor. Okay. So it's an object which is built. Okay. It depends on the position of the indices, but it's something like this. Okay. It's a trace of two. It's a partial trace of the Riemann tensor. Okay, so as you know, the Riemann tensor contains all the information about the metric, about the curvature of space. So a space-time is flat only if the full Riemann tensor in all its components is equal to zero. Okay, but since this is a partial trace of the Riemann tensor, the fact that this is equal to zero does not imply, of course, that this is equal to zero. Okay. Good. What else? What do I have to assume? Okay, this is a very general equation. This is an equation that holds whenever you are in empty space. Okay, so it will describe. So this equation will describe, for example, gravitational waves propagating in vacuum. It will describe all the possible solutions outside sources without any signature. So in general, again, not only this equation is extremely complicated, but also this equation is extremely complicated. There is no way to solve this equation, to classify, to give you all the possible solutions of this metric. Okay? So I have to do some assumptions to get this metric. And the assumptions are the ones of symmetry. Okay, as it's usually the case in physics, imposing symmetries allows to simplify a lot the equation. And the symmetries that we are going to impose for the moment are spherical symmetry. And time independence. So, I would say that this method is static. Okay, a few things. First of all, I will discuss about the fact that this assumption, at a certain point, that we can relax it, but for the time being, let's keep it. I will say something towards the end. What do I mean by this? Well, first of all, let's talk about this static. By static, I will be more explicit, but you sometimes read the adjective static and the adjective stationary. Static, basically, in words, means something which is not only time independent, but also time reversal symmetric. Okay, so let me do an example. So, if I have a black hole or an object which is rotating, okay, at a steady state, okay, so some star which is in vacuum which is just rotating. Okay, now the metric outside will not depend on time because it's just stationary. On the other hand, the metric will change if I flip the direction of time, because of course the fact that it's rotating influences the metric. Okay, so this is stationary. And in fact, we are going to study also rotating black holes, and we are going to impose that they are stationary but not static. On the other hand, static means really that is not only there is no time dependence, and also there is time reverse asymmetry. In the sense, I don't see if I give you the same solution with the time. Run in the opposite direction, I'll get the same solution. Okay. Yeah, so let me. This is different from stationary. Okay. Notice that we are facing a problem. Which is the following. You learned that you can write solutions using all the coordinates that you like. On the other hand, it's not very clear how to impose these symmetries. Okay. So for the time being, since this is the first explicit solution that we find, I will be a bit, I will play a bit. At a certain point, we are going to study a bit more precisely what does it mean in general relativity to have a solution with symmetry. So, symmetries of a metric are called isometries. Okay. You didn't study isometries with Merdad, no? Okay. So we are going to study precisely what it means. Of course, the concept of having a metric with some symmetry, some isometry, will be a concept which is coordinate independent. So it is not, you can choose, if you are crazy, use the coordinates that you like, but the fact that, for example, Minkowski space is rotational invariant, I mean, if you are crazy, use crazy coordinates, it will be a mess, but in some diff invariant way, there is a concept of being rotational invariant. So, these will not, so for the time being, I just focus on particular coordinates. So you will miss at the beginning how to generalize this to make some statement which is coordinate invariant. Okay, but for the time being, let's use this as an example, and then we are going to be a bit more systematic. So it's so probably this is the way Schwarzschild argued at the beginning. Okay, so you want to write something which is time independent. Well, time independent, it will mean that the metric does not depend on t. Okay. So t will not appear. In fact, it does not appear in any entry of the metric. Okay. Okay, notice that, again, I will discuss this at the end, but already this statement is coordinate dependent. So I want just to stress that this makes, what I'm going to say makes a lot of sense, but it makes a lot of sense if I choose the coordinates that I'm going to say. So basically what I'm saying is I have a concept of time independence, and since I'm not stupid, I want to use coordinates that make this symmetry manifest. Okay, so since I want some time independence, let me use as a good variable, I use t, and I make that the metric does not depend on t. Okay. So this is actually what we mean by stationary. So if the metric does not depend explicitly on t, it's stationary. But we want something more, we want staticity. And staticity, you know, you want that the metric is invariant if I flip the direction of time. So this means that I don't want off-diagonal terms of the form dt, whatever, dt, any variable, dt, dx, I mean, dt, dr, dt, d phi, dt, d theta. Okay. Why? Well, because it's clear that these off-diagonal terms, if I flip the direction of time, they will change sign. So the metric will not be invariant if I run the movie in one direction compared to running backwards. Okay. Again, this is something that makes sense, but it's coordinate dependent. Right. So I will write a metric which in which time does not, does not appear in the entries of the metric, and also I will write a metric that does not contain these off-diagonal pieces. For example, when we are going to talk about rotating black holes, this part of the metric will be there. So there will be off-diagonal pieces of this kind, and this will be a stationary and not static space-time. Good. So this is one. Now we have to impose a spherical symmetry.
Well, let's start with the following. So,
imagine that we want to study spherical symmetry in Minkowski. So, in Minkowski, if somebody tell you, let me discuss about a problem which is spherically symmetric in Minkowski, the first thing that you do is you write Minkowski in coordinates which are not x, y, z, t, x, y, and z, but you write it in this fashion. So in the same thing I discussed now. Okay. So this is just Minkowski, just written in other coordinates. But again, these coordinates are good to discuss spherical symmetries because, as we discussed, it's explicit that at a given r, at a given r and t, you are living on a two-dimensional sphere. Okay. Now, written in this form, okay, so we want a space-time which is spherically symmetric. So you're not surprised if I tell you that you want this part of the metric to remain the same. In other words, you want a metric that if I give you these coordinates, if you fix the time and you fix the radius, now you live on a two-dimensional surface, and you want this surface to be a two-sphere. So this is Minkowski. Now let's get an answer for what we're looking for. So I will be generic. So I use this, and I use this intuition that I want this object, that is to say this object, which is a metric on a two-sphere. So let me write a metric here, which is t squared is equal to minus e to the 2 alpha over t squared. So I'm just writing an answer. And I want you to be convinced that this is the most general object I can write down. Yes. Okay. What did they do? Well, I'm just using this. So I didn't write these terms. I didn't write any dependence on time. And I also said, being spherically symmetric means that I need to have this object. Not only, it means that theta and phi can only appear inside this object. So you're not surprised, if I put theta here, you're going to immediately say that it's not
spherically symmetric because there is an explicit theta dependence. So you want that if I fix the R and T, okay, in this metric, you want that you are on a two-sphere. So once you do that, you must be on a manifold with this metric. And this is exactly what happens in this case. Any question?
Is it we have to impose that it's asymptotically flat, or is going to be our solution will already give us this, or we should impose on those functions in front of the DTDR to vanish it when R not vanish it goes to one.
At a certain point, what is asking, which is a good question. So. Of course, when I say Schwarzschild solution and I talk about this symmetry, what we have in mind is also that is a solution which is asymptotically flat. Asymptotically flat, okay, it has a formal meaning, but it just means that if you go far away, it becomes Minkowski. Okay, so this is something that we are going to impose at a certain point. We see, but it's an additional information.
But okay. Whenever we have a local source.
I'm trying to understand if there could be some exception. What I said is not correct. So in any sense, since we have a lot of symmetries, this will come automatically. In a sense, for example. This solution it will come a bit more explicit in a moment, it's automatic. So in a sense, in principle, you could expect that very far away from this object. For example, there are large gravitational waves, okay, but these are not compatible with the symmetry that we have. Okay, so you see, if the idea is that I have a localized object here, okay, if I go far from this object, if I do not impose any symmetry, there is no guarantee that I end up in Minkowski far away. For example, I could end up in a situation which there are large gravitational waves going around, okay, and this will be a solution of this equation, but the point is that this situation, the possibility that far away you are not in Minkowski is ruled out because I imposed this symmetry. So I imposed that, once you impose that far away, you keep spherical symmetry and you keep time invariance, you end up automatically to a metric which is flat. Thanks. Any other question?
The reason we didn't put theta of phi dependence to the exponents is that we fix R, and do we fix also T, or fix T,
yeah,
there might be a theta dependence in the factor in front of T, because we never see for a fixed T, also for the R.
You are saying. Let me try to understand. So you're saying, imagine that I replace this with this.
Yes.
Yeah. This. Thanks. What I said is not very correct. It's true, what you're saying is that even if you allow for some theta dependence here, it still remains true that the metric, once I fix the R and T, so I don't look at these pieces, is still a two-dimensional sphere. Sorry, what I'm implicitly assuming is the following, this metric is rotational invariant, okay? So what I'm implicitly saying is that I was in the back of my mind saying something more than what I said. For example, the symmetry, so in the same way as the time translational symmetry is explicit in the fact that the metric does not depend on t, the rotational symmetry, for example, around the z-axis is the independence on theta. So, but you're completely right. So I'm saying something more. I'm implicitly saying that the rotational symmetries are implemented in the way these coordinates make explicit. So, for example, the rotation around the z-axis is just a translation in phi, okay, and the rotation around the other axis act in the usual way. Okay, but thanks. So it was not. You see what that I'm already. But this question makes perfect sense. So now we are going in this direction because we know more or less what we are talking about. But if I was trying to implement some other symmetries, it would be very not easy to understand how to choose the form of the metric. Okay, that's why it would be useful to discuss about isometries. Okay, so at this time I'm trying to use some intuition. I want basically t, phi, and the theta to behave as the name suggests. Okay, which is not very precise, but it works. Okay, so now, explicitly write, maybe it's better if I put the radius here, okay. R squared here. Okay. Now, let me do one step that I think it's a good example to understand that, remember that coordinates in general relativity are just labels that we put to points, okay? So I want to claim the following, that there is no loss in generality if I call this R squared. Let me call it R bar squared. Okay. Why? Well, because, I didn't choose, so I write this out of the blue. So R, I didn't commit, so R is just a special coordinate. So I can I can change basically the name that I give at the various points. In particular, I can do this. Imagine that I call this R squared. I call this equal to this. Okay. Let's change coordinates basically. Let's go from this variable R to this variable R bar defined this way. Okay. So you do a change of coordinates and dr bar is equal to e to the gamma dr plus e to the gamma r dr. Okay, so everything is a function. So it's just a one dimensional redefinition. R bar is a function of r. So of course, if I redefine these, I get this relation. So I should put this back here, but again, since I didn't specify this function, nothing changes. And since I didn't specify what R is, I can call it R bar. Okay. So I mean, just to say that it's free to call this R bar. So there is an advantage. So not only we have one less function, but now this variable R bar now has one interesting meaning, because now it is true that if I restrict to constant time and constant r, now I live on a two-dimensional sphere with radius r bar. Okay. So now you cannot ask too much to a curved geometry. So this variable r bar, which from now on I will call r, because this variable r, it has a good meaning that r is the radius of the two sphere where I live. But of course, I cannot ask too much. This will not be the distance from the center, because again, we are not in flat space, so there is no guarantee that, in general, it will not work that if I have a certain distance from the center, you will see that in this geometry, the constant of center, as you can see here, if I go to small r, something crazy will happen. But anyway, I just stress that For the metric, you read that R is the radius of the sphere of the two spheres where you are living. Okay, this is correct because R equal to constant, this drops, and I'm left with R squared the omega squared. Okay, but do not look at it thinking that it's a distance from a center because we are not in flat space, so this will not occur. You see it eventually. We're going to see it from here. So close. For a small r, this geometry does not behave at all as our intuition would say. So, but take this example to remember that really coordinates are just labels, so I'm free to redefine them in the way I prefer. In this case, it makes a lot of sense to call r the radius of the two spheres. So, another important point that maybe it's obvious, but let me stress it, is that somebody, so you're going to be, if you look at Wikipedia, probably this is described as the Schwarzschild solution, which makes a lot of sense. But notice that there is no sense, there's no unique way of writing the solution. Okay? So, in the same way, since the theory is coordinate invariant, this is one way to represent the Schwarzschild solution. Okay. So if I do a redefinition of coordinates in the same way I do for Minkowski, so Minkowski is both minus dt squared plus dx squared plus dy squared plus dz squared, but Minkowski is also this metric. Okay. So, and not, I say this not only to stress this property of generativity, but also to stress that it's not true, this form of the metric is useful to describe, as Schwarzschild was thinking about, to describe physics in the quasi-Newtonian limit, so far from the object, but it will not be at all transparent when I go very close to the black hole. Okay? So we are going to need to change coordinates many times. Okay? So,
what to say is, we label these coordinates like t, r, theta, and phi, which reminds us the three-dimensional quantities. Actually, they correspond to the usual quantities when we go away from the metric. So in that area, when we are away, those names will be the same, will have the same meaning that we are used to, but
yes.
Not in the close.
This is what I'm saying. So very thanks for saying it because I didn't say that. One good thing is the following, that as you said, in the limit in which r becomes large, okay, all these terms will become subdominant, and so you are also ended the metric which is already written in this form. So it's clear that it's clear that it's asymptotically flat, because from this point of view, the intuition is these coordinates are chosen in such a way that they give you good intuition when you are far from the object. They are also good to the extent that you remain outside what we call the horizon. Okay, and of course you can always do calculation in any coordinates you like. What I'm saying is that if they are well suited to study problems far from the black hole. Once you go close to the black hole, it will be useful to change coordinates. Okay.
But when we say that we can take the Newtonian limit and give a meaning to all of this, do we always mean that there is a black hole there that we are far away from, or can we just use this for like stars or planets to?
Good. Good. Not the answer question. Sorry. Say again.
This solution always describes a black hole, or not? Like you
very
can
good.
See that there is a limit, but if you want to describe a planetary or a star alone in the universe using this metric, can I do it also with this metric?
Yeah. It's a very good question. Mathematically, the way we are going to derive it is just to impose this symmetry. So this solution will describe outside the source. So of course, it will be a solution of this equation. So it will be valid only if you are far, if you are not far, outside the surface of the object, but it will describe any astrophysical object if the symmetry are respected. Okay? So in particular, this is this can be used for describe the sun. Actually, this is the one of the main point that will be done. It will be a good description of the Earth and so on and so forth. So it's so the fact that it describes black holes is only I mean let me stress it. When I write this metric, I don't mean that there is a black hole. In a sense, this metric may be valid only for sufficiently large radii because I'm solving this equation. But it's nothing fancy. It's the same thing that I do in electromagnetism or Newtonian physics. So I give you, for example, a distribution of charge. Of course, when you solve it outside, you always get the same solution. Now, whether I can extrapolate to small radii, it depends on what is the distribution. Okay? So the solution describes both, in this case, any object which has these symmetries. So it could be a black hole or not, depending on at which radius I start finding matter. Good. Okay. So now there is a part which is sort of straightforward. So the logic is the following. So I drop this this function because now I convinced you that I can call this r squared. And there is a bit of calculation to do that I'm not going to do on the blackboard, which is just, everything now is pretty simple. There are only two functions on one variable, okay? So you have to sit down and calculate and write this equation, okay? These equations, because there are many equations. Let me write them. Yeah?
Why we didn't change the r squared as obtained in the coordinate?
Why we didn't change this?
Yeah.
Good question, sorry, maybe I was not... because I did it, but so as I wrote here, when I change from r bar, from r to r bar, I would change this part. I would change it. On the other hand, since this function is a free function, whatever comes out in front, I will call the new object, I will call it e to beta. Yeah, so you're completely right. So if I do everything, I would have to change. Also, I would have to change also here, no?
Yeah, but we will have in the new dr squared, we will have a factor of r in
yeah.
Now, not as an exponential, but as a an exponential multiplier with
yeah.
r. So
yes. So I will get something. Sorry, I forget. But it's something like this, no? The gamma in the r, something like this, no? So you are saying that I will get something like this,
and also something with r in
yeah.
in.
No, no, but okay. Whatever is in front, okay. It's thanks for so that. So anyway, whatever is in front, I call this object e to the 2 beta.
Okay.
No, but this reminds me something that I didn't say. So. It's a bit, so I call this object e to the something. Well, just to simplify the algebra.
Mm-hmm.
So as it's already clear from there, these objects will not be positive everywhere. Okay? So I call them, at the beginning I call them like this because I would like this to remain at time. So I would like this not to change sign. As we see, this is impossible. So I still like to call it e to the 2 alpha because it simplifies a bit the algebra, but it's just by this. So anyway, to answer your question, when I do the change of the radial coordinate, of course I have to change what is in front, but whatever is there, I will call it e to the 2 beta. Okay.
But this quantity always positive?
Let's go step by step. Let's for the time being assume that it's positive, okay? And you see from there, well, it's a bit, so let me put it this way. So for the time being, let's assume this parenthesis to be positive, and then we are going to study what happens as we try to approach this point where this vanishes, okay? So, okay, maybe because you know already, from the time being, you may be suspicious, you may say, okay, maybe some craziness will happen when this goes to zero. So let's, for the time being, assume, as Schwarzschild, I think, that this parenthesis is positive, okay? And then we're going to discuss whether it can become negative. Okay, as I said, there is a bit of straightforward calculation that you have to do. So I remind you, you have some couple of hours free. And what we have to do? Well, we have to sit down, you take the metric, which is in this form. You calculate the Christoffel symbols. Okay, so you can ask also Mathematica to do it. So you calculate all the Christoffel symbols, and you remember that then from the Christoffel symbols, you can derive the Riemann tensor, and in particular, I can trace the Riemann tensor to give the Ricci tensor. Okay. So it's not particularly difficult, because everything is a function of only two functions of one variable, so it's not... it's a bit... I mean, it's not easy enough to do on the blackboard, but I'll tell you what are the results. So prime just means derivative with respect to the only variable, which is R. Okay, so this is RTT. So all these components must be equal to zero. Because, again, the Einstein's equation are all components of the Ricci must be equal to zero. All the other components, the one that I do not write, turns out to be zero. Okay? So let me just to make, I mean, of course you are aware of it, but just to tell you how complicated are Einstein's equations. So even in this very, 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 very simplified case, in which I'm left only with two functions of one variable, still, okay, you can do it, it's not, but it's, it takes a bit of time, but indeed I didn't do it explicitly on the blackboard. So just to tell you how difficult in general would be to solve the Einstein's equation if you have less symmetries. Okay, so these are the components, the non-zero components of the Ricci tensor. So in particular, now I want to solve it. So you see that in particular this is quite similar to this. This is quite similar to this. Okay, you see that the thing in parentheses looks very similar. Okay, so in particular I can take a combination of this. Okay, I can take the combination e to the 2 beta minus alpha times RTT. Plus RR. Okay, if you do that, you see that multiplying this by this, this goes away. So I'm summing these two. So this goes away with this, this goes away with this, this goes away with this, this does not go away with this. So they sum. So I'm left with 2 over R, this combination, which is alpha prime plus beta prime. Okay? So this object need to be zero. Okay, so this is zero by Einstein's equation. So this means that alpha prime plus beta prime is equal to zero. So this means that the derivative relative to R of alpha plus beta is equal to zero. So which means that this object is just a constant. Just a constant. Now, I can do something more because, now we are used, we can redefine coordinates, okay? In particular, what I can do? I can redefine time by a constant, Okay, so I do a change of coordinates, and the new time is a constant times the old time. Okay. Now this does not do much. It's only rescale dt squared. Okay. So if you do this, you are going to get a constant in front of this term. But you see, a constant here means a shift of the exponent. That's why it's useful to keep these exponents, basically. This means that alpha is not uniquely defined. So until I specify which time I use, this constant alpha can change by a constant. So I choose this constant for this to be zero. Okay. So you see that when I do these tricks, there would be nothing wrong if I give you this metric putting some constant here, no? So this would be still a solution of Einstein's equation. Of course,
I'm trying to learn the names. Are you more Mehmet or more Asim?
I don't know, even you prefer As.
As, even...
Okay, no, can I like Bas.
Okay, as As was saying, we are trying to use variables that far from the object become the same as in Minkowski. So I could give you the metric in this form, okay? Then you will be a bit puzzled because you say very far away there is a 2 here, right? Of course, we choose. It's not clear that I anticipate that the choice of setting this equal to 0 corresponds to giving to a smart choice of what I call time. Any question? Okay. So this is what I get. So now I'm left with one function because alpha is equal to minus beta. Alpha is equal to minus beta means that this function is 1 over this function, and indeed is what happens in the explicit solution. Now let's use this. Okay. I can erase this. So I use this. Yes, so I impose r theta theta equal to 0, and I use that alpha is equal to minus beta. What I get is e to the 2 alpha times 2r alpha prime plus 1 equal to 1. Okay? So this object is nothing more than the derivative of r e to the 2 alpha prime equal to 1. Okay, so if you do the derivative of this, you get, when this act this, you get e to the 2 alpha, which is this. If you act this, you get e to the 2 alpha times alpha prime times 2r, so this is equal to this. I can integrate, so I integrate, so I get that this is r plus a constant. Okay, so this r simplify with this, and this becomes a constant over r. Okay. Okay. So we're almost done. This constant I don't know the sign, so let me call it this. For the time being, this constant, I don't know which is the sign, but the good thing is that we derive that this is a solution of vacuum Einstein's equation, but we still have to decide what this constant is. Okay. Now, so the next step is to understand why I call this constant 2gm. Okay. Any question about this?
Do we fix this concept to be dependent on the variable because of the spherical symmetry? Do we fix it to be dependent on phi or theta because we are assume the spherical symmetry? Or not?
Sorry, you're talking about this constant? Yes, of course. You're asking why this constant does not depend on the coordinates.
Yeah.
No, but notice that from the beginning, I argue that the metric can be cast in this form. So, when I write this form, it's already clear that these functions only depend on the radius, on the variable r. So they do not, I'm already arguing at this level that they do not depend on theta and phi.
Yes, 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 yes.
Now, again, as was saying, I'm a bit cheating in a sense. Let's put it this way. I'm trying to look at a solution of this form. In a sense, it's also a sort of bootstrap procedure. In a sense, I'm sort of doing an ansatz, which makes a lot of sense because I'm arguing, okay, I don't have time dependence, blah, blah, blah. At a certain point, I have these ansatz in which these functions do not depend on theta and phi. I try to solve the equation and I find a solution. So from this point of view, at the end it works. In principle, I don't know, in another situation, if you, because this is quite simple, but if somebody hands you some symmetry, for example, imagine that tomorrow I ask you, can you try to generalize this to have a rotating black hole? Okay, then you start saying, I don't know, yes, let me put a bit of dr dt and try to find whether there is a solution, but maybe you're going to find that it's not enough. Okay, there is some sort of engineering. In this case, it works. So, anyway, to answer your question, I assume that these are not theta and phi dependence, and so this constant is just a constant, it does not depend on any coordinate. Okay, so how would you fix this constant? There are proposals. Excellent, excellent. You see that the course of Mercatus. good. No, it makes a lot of sense. So, yes, so we want, physically what we want is that far away from this object, I should go back to a Newtonian approximation, okay? So, one question. So, if I say the following statement, does it ring a bell or not? So, I claim that in the Newtonian limit, G00, it's minus 1 minus 2 the Newtonian potential. Does this ring some bell? How many bells it rings? Because somebody was, so did it, no, I mean, my question is, maybe some of you is an expert on this, but did Merdad went through this? He did, okay. So I just remind you, just for, so it's also in my notes, if somebody is not, forgot, so just to be very explicit, what you can do, just to remind yourself, I'm sure that Merdad did it, but just to remind yourself, is the following. So, I want to take general relativity and go back to Newton, okay? So first of all, so I have two pieces. So one, I want to reproduce, starting from the geodesic equation, I want to go back and find an equation that tells me that basically the acceleration is minus the gradient of the Newtonian potential, okay? So I take the geodesic equation, I go to the non-relativistic limit, which means basically that my curve basically moves only in the time direction, because it's non-relativistic. So it simplifies, and the bottom line is that you find that the acceleration is related to the gradient of this object. Okay, so this suggests that this is a Newtonian potential. Then, to match also with the Poisson equation, with the equation that tells you that Laplacian of phi is sourced by the energy density, so you take the Einstein's equation, the 0-0 component of Einstein's equation, that erase the Einstein's equation, you go to the non-relativistic limit, and you find that you get Laplacian of this object equal to a constant times the stress energy tensor. If you remember, probably this is the way you fix the 8 pi g on the right-hand side of Einstein's equation. Okay. Okay. Anyway, this is just to remind you. If you didn't follow what I said, please go to the notes or ask me. But this should be clear. So the bottom line again is that if I take emetrically this, I want that this object, this object describes the Newtonian potential. And that's is what I do. So so I remind you that the Newtonian potential in Newtonian gravity is minus gm over r. Okay. So you see that with this choice, okay, this factor of two drops because it's in the definition of G0, in the relation between G0 and phi, and so you find here the Newtonian potential. Notice that you need the minus sign. Okay. So in other words, okay, this is a bit subtle, but anyway, in principle, I could also have a constant with the opposite sign here. At the level of being a solution of Einstein's equation, is still a solution of vacuum Einstein's equation. Of course, it will correspond to have an object with negative mass. I mean, it's not so different in Newtonian gravity. If somebody comes and tells you, "I want this solution," okay, it's a solution of Laplacian of phi equal to zero outside the source, but does not correspond to a positive mass. Okay.
For the expression for G0, we assume that it's in the weak field limit, right?
Yes. Sorry, this maybe I should put a squiggle here. In the sense that this identification only makes sense. Thanks for reminding. Sorry, when I do the non-relativistic approximation, means that I'm taking this object to be much smaller than unity. Okay, so this is a part of the approximation you do when you do the non-relativistic limit. So this identification makes sense only when this is small. So it does not make any sense if I ask you, and you should not think about this as Newtonian potential when this becomes comparable to unity.
Yes, but we were lucky that even the exact solution has a form that in the weak limit it matches.
Yes.
In the weak and generalized.
Yes, so I'm trying to understand. Yes. No, is that. Should I read some meaning into this? No, I should not read it. Maybe there is some deep meaning. So what he's saying is that, and I think it's, as far as I know, I don't find any profound interpretation in this, is that by chance it turns out that the full function of R is exactly the form 1 over R like in Newtonian gravity. I'm aware, I mean, if you take, for example, a charged black hole, this function is much more complicated. So, in general, it will not work. There are some leading terms which are not on the form of 1 over R. But thanks for pointing out. So, it's for example, if here I would have a function which includes also something of the form 1 over R squared, I would just care about the 1 over R dependence. In a sense, or something which is subleading as I go far away, I would just drop it. So the mass, this is more general the ones. So basically, the Newtonian mass as always has to do with the 1 over R the fall off of the metric at infinity. Okay, so this fixes the mass. In this case, it turns out that there is only this 1 over R dependence. Okay. Now somebody come to the blackboard. Okay, I can take a pause.
Yes.
Okay. Okay, so we found that the Schwarzschild radius of the sun. The Schwarzschild radius of the sun is around 3 kilometers. Okay, remember that you have to. So, this is an important trick. So remember to check units. Of course, we're always working with C equal to unity, but if one asks a question, wants that you are smart enough to remember that you have to go back to normal units. The Schwarzschild radius of an object is inversely proportional to the mass. Notice that this is something usually. So it has to do with the fact that we are talking about gravity. So usually so if you have an object, you associate going to large energies means going to short distances usually, no? In when you're talking about particle physics. Here it's the opposite. It has to do with the fact that G has dimension, okay? But it's important that here there is a radius which increases as the mass of the object increases, okay? Okay. And in the case of a sun, it's 3 kilometers. Now, question, what happens, what this number says about our sun? So what happens at 3 kilometers? So we measure this number. So what are the implications of this number for in the case of a sun?
That slice we have
approximation
of a black hole
with
the mass of the sun.
No. Okay, this was a tricky question, but be careful because this is a typical question. So, you know, this is what is the answer that I wanted. So it's okay. but be very careful again. This metric for the sun only makes sense outside the sun because again we are solving r mu nu equal to zero. So this is a good approximation for the sun, of course, assuming that the sun is spherically symmetric, which is a good approximation. Assuming also that the rotation of the sun is not so important because we assume staticity, but this is a good approximation. But also it's crucial that we have to remain outside the sun. Once you go inside the sun, then the Einstein's equation are different. There is stress energy tensor. So this number, nothing happens at 3 kilometers from the center because this metric does not apply when you go inside the sun. This does not mean that it's useful to remember this number because, okay, if I am at a certain distance from the sun, the ratio between 3 kilometers and this will tell me since the Newtonian expansion has to do with small phi, okay, all corrections to Newtonian physics will come as ratio between the distance compared to 3 kilometers. So it's still important to remember this number, but remember that this solution does not apply when I go inside an astrophysical object. Okay, the last piece of information before concluding is something that I don't want to discuss in details, but it's important that you know. It's what is called Birkhoff's theorem. How many F has Birkhoff? 2, apparently. I'm not sure. So what does this theorem say? Let me be explicit. So imagine that I drop this assumption. So I tell you, let's restart the lesson, and we do the same, but I do not assume that the metric is time independent. Okay. So I do not assume nothing. I do not assume staticity. I do not assume stationarity. So I drop this. Of course, now everything is more complicated because time will appear in many places in the metric. Okay. So it will be a bit more work to do. Okay. But the conclusion will be the same. Okay. So Birkhoff's theorem says that the only vacuum solution. Vacuum in the sense without stress energy tensor. So the only vacuum solution of general relativity which is spherically symmetric is the Schwarzschild solution. Okay? So, for example, it tells you that what is the implication? Imagine that I have an astrophysical object like a star which is evolving in time. For example, it is collapsing in a spherically symmetric way, but or it's pulsating, but in a spherically symmetric way. Well, outside the star, the metric will always be given by Schwarzschild, okay? Which is remarkable, okay? So I dropped a lot of assumptions, but I'm left with the same equation. Yeah. No, rotation is not allowed, be careful, eh? Be careful. So again, I assume spherical symmetry, I mean full rotation asymmetry, not rotation over one angle. Okay, so of course I'm only allowing the astrophysical object to pulsate or to contract isotropically, but if I assume this, I'm left only with the same Schwarzschild metric. Okay. Yeah. So intuitively, it tells you that, for example, maybe it's not so surprising because imagine that you have a spherically symmetric object which is pulsating. Okay. Well, of course, it would emit. So the point is that whether it emits or not gravitational waves. Okay. Well, this is one possibility of deviating from this. I don't know, you can be more creative. But I mean, the fact that it's not producing gravitational waves, it has to do with that this configuration has zero quadrupole. Okay. But notice that I'm not doing any approximation here. Here, this is an exact statement. It's not a statement about linearized GR. Okay. So I cannot just say, okay, there is zero quadrupole, because this holds also very close to the object, outside the object, but also in a regime in which this approximation is not correct. So it's an exact state. Okay? So this is what Birkhoff's theorem says. I'm not going to go through it. If you're interested in the details, just to take a look, for example, in Wald's book, there is the derivation, just to, if you want to see how it works. Okay. Let's conclude here.